Hey there, I'm Rohan Kokula and welcome to my YouTube channel. In this video, I'll be explaining 10 activation functions in 10 minutes. So what are activation functions? So in a neural network, activation function helps neuron to get activated or not. So if you look at the sample model over here, inputs are multiplied with the weights and their summation is added to the activation function along with the bias. So this is just like x1 into w1 plus x2 into w2 dot dot xm into wm plus bias. The calculated answer is fed as input to the activation function, and depending on the threshold of the function, it decides whether to fire it or not. Okay, that's cool, but why do we use an activation function? So if we don't have the activation function, the weights and bias would simply do a linear transformation, and that neural network becomes a linear regression model. Derivatives of activation functions are very important in backpropagation. When updating the curve of loss function, activation functions help the gradient descent algorithm to converge to their local minima. So let's start with very first activation function, sigmoid or logistic function. So the formula is 1 upon 1 plus e raised to minus beta x. Here, beta is responsible for the smoothness of the curve. So if you keep on increasing the value of beta, there will be a point where sigmoid function will be a replica of stepwise function. For a particular neuron, x is the summation of inputs into weight plus bias. And this value of x goes as an input to the sigmoid function. So basically, sigmoid function normalizes this input into 0 to 1 range. So whatever your input value be, the output will be always in the range of 0 and 1. So there are few advantages and disadvantages, such as differentiable and smooth gradient normalizing. You can check out this web app from the description. So let's quickly jump to our next activation function, hyperbolic tangent. If you'll compare this with the sigmoid function, you'll observe that sigmoid function is not zero-centric, which is actually a disadvantage for sigmoid function. Let's get back to tanh. This overcomes the disadvantage of sigmoid function being non-zero-centric. Just like beta in sigmoid function, theta is responsible for the curvature. So unlike sigmoid function, range of hyperbolic tangent function is between minus 1 to plus 1. If you are working with a binary classification problem, this is the best fit. Use this in the hidden layer and sigmoid function in the output layer. Major advantages are zero-centered and being smooth gradient. The disadvantages are vanishing gradient, slow convergence, and slower computation due to the exponential calculations. Third activation function is rectified linear unit. Let me put in simple terms. If your value of x is greater than 0, then output will be x, and if it's less than 0, then output will be 0. So no matter what your value is beyond 0, if your value is x, then output will be x. But if your value is negative, output will be 0, which means the neuron is dead for all the negative values, which contributes to the disadvantage, the dying ReLU problem. Also, it is not a zero-centric function. Advantages are function and its derivative both are monotonic, it is computationally efficient, and it's non-linear. To avoid dying of neuron for negative values, Leaky ReLU comes to the rescue. The formula stays same for the positive values, that is linear, and for negative values it is 0.01 into x, which is 1% of the negative value, which helps the neuron not to die in case of negative values. Since 0.01 is a constant multiplier of x, what if we'll convert this into a learnable parameter which comes from backpropagation? Oh yes, we already have it in parametric ReLU function. If you'll replace this alpha with 0.01, it will act as a leaky ReLU function. So by doing this, we give more power to the neuron in terms of learnability for backpropagation. What if for negative values, we need exponential functionality instead of linear multiplicity? Well, that's our next activation function, exponential linear unit. Note that for positive values of input, ELU is same as ReLU. Here, alpha is a constant multiplier which acts as a learnable parameter. If we'll talk about advantages, there is no dead ReLU problem, and also this is zero-centered. Since there is a presence of exponent calculations, you need to pay for it. On moving further, we have Swish function. This is simply x multiplied by sigmoid of x. This function was released by researchers at Google Brain in 2017. If the value of beta is way too high, then it becomes the replica of ReLU function. Let's move to next activation function, SoftMax. Based on input values to a neuron, SoftMax function converts them into their probabilistic occurrence. So if you have 5 inputs, then there will be 5 outputs based on each other's probability. So if suppose some input values are large, then their probabilities will also be on the larger side. Let's try it out. If there's a single element, then obviously the probability will be 1. And if there are more than one element, for example 6 and 4, the probabilities will be higher for 6 and lower for 4. One thing to notice that the summation of the outputs is always equals to 1. Which is a major advantage of using SoftMax functions. Here comes the next activation function, SoftPlus. This is just a smoother version of ReLU function. And as I previously said, if there's an exponent, you need to pay for higher computation. Suppose input is -0.001. So in case of ReLU, due to negative value, it deactivates the neuron. Let's go to our last function, Maxout. Maxout activation is generalization of the ReLU and leaky ReLU function. It basically outputs the maximum of calculated inputs. Let's try with our examples. Let's select input value x1 as 0 and its corresponding weight as 2. So 0 multiplied by 2, which gives 0, minus 2, and the output of I is minus 2. Suppose we have another input neuron with value as 3 and its corresponding weight as 3. So 3 multiplied by 3 gives 9 and minus 2 is 7. So maximum of -2, 7 will be 7. Let's change value of W1 and bias to 0. I'm doing this to create a replica of ReLU function. So now we have maximum of 0, x. And if we'll further change the values of x2 to some negative value, the output of maxout function will be 0. This is how maxout function can act like ReLU function. Thanks for watching. Are you on LinkedIn? Let's connect. Like this video if it helped to build your fundamentals in neural networks. Share this to your friends who is a beginner to neural network or who needs a recap to activation functions. And finally, subscribe to my channel and press the bell icon so that you'll be notified for my further videos.